This is BH the Uncivilized. I'm going to be doing another film analysis. Today I'm talking about Prometheus. This will contain spoilers, so if you haven't seen it already, you may want to watch that first and then come back to this video afterwards and let me know what you think then. Now, Prometheus is a 2012 film by Ridley Scott that acts as somewhat of a pseudo prequel to the Alien films. It features a group of explorers looking for the creators or engineers of humanity to find the reasons why we were made. This is the main theme throughout the film, the idea of looking for the genesis of humans. Now, before I start, as this is dealing with beliefs, I recognize that many different people have many different beliefs. So to be clear, whatever it is you choose to believe about the creation of people, this is not any kind of an attempt to change that. All I'm trying to do here is explore the ideas presented in the film. Now, firstly, the name of the film and the spaceship in the film, Prometheus, as mentioned by Peter Wayland, is named after the Titan of Greek mythology. Now, I prefer not to go into Greek mythology too much because it can get overly complicated and not really relevant to the film. But briefly, Prometheus was a Titan that was banished from Olympus for stealing fire and giving it to humans. Now, some say he stayed banished and disgraced for all eternity. Some say he was eventually rescued by Hercules. But as I said, I don't want to go into it too much. So for now, I'm just going to be sticking with what Wayland said as it foreshadows to some extent the eventual outcome of the ship, and that is also doomed to never return home. Now, that's all well and good, but what does any of that mean? You know, so what if it foreshadows events? What is it trying to tell us? Now, I think that one of the messages of the film is those who attempt to be equal to God would always fail, and perhaps also acceptance of God, or at least acceptance of an afterlife, can lead to internal peace, even if it is just for one's final moments. For example, if we look at Holloway and Yannick, they both place their arms apart as if on a crucifix before their respective ends. Holloway in particular, after being affected, he became ready and willing to meet his fate at Vickers' hand. I think at this point he either saw or felt something that perhaps showed him some evidence of the afterlife, something that made him desire it. If we consider when he first realized he was infected with something, he tried to hide it. Only when it became obvious, he said something. So what happened between then and Vickers' flamethrower that made him ready? Now, let's go back a little further. We, the audience, know that Holloway became ill from the substance that David took from the vase found in a cave. What is that substance? The exact answer we don't know. Some kind of blood, maybe. What we do know from the film is that it causes cell breakdown and or mutation. David at one point remarks that the reason the engineers were heading back to Earth was to destroy then rebuild. This could be also a reference to the beginning of the film where we see the engineer drinking the substance, then subsequently breaking down, suggesting this was the beginning of mankind. With that said, I think it's possible that this substance, whatever it may be, can also let their body it's inhabited in experience the truth of creation. Now, that being said, perhaps the truth of creation that Holloway saw was actually no afterlife and he just didn't want to live anymore. The other potential message of the film is the pursuit of science is the ultimate victory. Although fair to say that, sure, the true believer was the only survivor of the Prometheus, she was ultimately there for the same reasons. And at the end, when everyone is dead, David is all but destroyed, sure, only barely surviving herself, and it's abundantly clear they weren't welcome. She still chooses to continue her search in an alien spaceship from a hostile planet to an unknown place on her own with a broken robot, which she may or may not be able to fix. I wonder if in part two she'll still have an aversion to guns. Anyway, this all suggests to me that perhaps when it's all said and done, no matter the potential danger, one should keep searching for answers. In any case, the film approaches the idea of science versus religion in a way that doesn't promote one particular view over the other. The scene where Shaw has the baby alien extracted from her, when it is taken out, it's initially covered in this thin membrane film, then it bursts out and the membrane is completely gone. Considering the membrane was between the alien and the tongs, once it's gone, wouldn't that mean the alien would easily break free from the hold? It seemed highly improbable that the tongs would still be able to hold it. The scene alluding to Yannick and Vickers engaged in casual sex was a reference to an unfilmed scene from Alien, showing that the crew engage in casual sex as a way of fulfilling needs. However, I felt it devalued both characters, especially as it seems so out of place. Vickers is primarily presented as a no-nonsense boss, not there to make friends, there to make sure an agenda is reached. But all it takes is for the rugged, handsome captain to make a few disparaging remarks. And on Yannick's part, what are we, the audience, supposed to think of a man who insults women as means to sleeping with, as a means to sleeping with them, or whilst acting as if he's doing her a favor? The real problem is that it's placed to a myth that all women want is sex, and any behavior she displays is a message to that effect. It's old, it's been done way too many times before, and it's beyond time we move away from these limited, outdated notions. Now, speaking of Vickers, I came across some suggestions that Vickers is supposed to be a robot. This is based primarily on Yannick asking her if she is a robot and Vickers not really answering the question. We also know that David is a robot and considered in some way a son of Wayland, and later on in the film we see Vickers refer to Wayland as father. Although I think the theory has merits, I do also think there could be something else with Vickers. In another analysis I saw, it was pointed out that Vickers appears to be overpowering David at one point. And we know from the Alien films that robots are strong, so if Vickers can overpower it, could that make her a robot as well? Well, not necessarily. We also know that David is programmed to blend in, and although he can't feel human emotions, he does have at least some understanding of them, meaning it may not have been Vickers overpowering David, but David's programming responding to Vickers' aggression. Furthermore, as I said, we know from the Alien films that the robots are strong. Prometheus is set before that, so it is feasible that the earlier robots weren't made to be strong. Considered throughout the film, we don't really see any display of super strength from David. Now, my own theory on Vickers is that she is post-operation transsexual. Now, I know that may sound a little far-fetched, but let me explain. Mainly I'm basing this on the rare and expensive medical pod in her room being configured for men only. Although she will have the physical appearance of a woman, she would still have male internal organs. When Wayland refers to David as the closest thing to a son, we see Vickers at that point appear to not like that very much. This could be a sign that the choice has caused tension between Wayland and Vickers and could be the reason for their sour relationship. Now, I admit that this is a lot of speculation, but here's what I think could have happened between Wayland and Vickers. Wayland wanted to leave the company to his son, so when Vickers changed genders, Wayland didn't like this very much and decided to leave the business to someone else, perhaps divided between shareholders. This annoys Vickers, and the two begin to argue about a whole range of things, her life choices, the business, her upbringing, among other things. Note when Vickers said she didn't want to stay behind and argue over who's in charge. So although she may have felt entitled to take over the business, she decided it was better for her to be out there with the expedition, perhaps wanting to watch her father die. Now, of course, this is just my theory. It's entirely possible that by 2091, scientists have figured out ways to change the internal organs in transsexual operations, or that the medical pod was never meant for her to begin with. But that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. So that's what I think of Prometheus. Let me know if you agree, disagree, or if you think there's something that I've missed. Check out the other videos on the channel. I do plan on making more of these film analyses, so please subscribe to keep updated. And until next time, if you can't be with the one you love, love the one you're with.